We were under the British, so his father was the ruling chief. This is the father. The British gave him a mantle, so he's known as Sir Sao Kya. So under the British, he went to England to study. He studied a long time, got his MA, BA from Oxford University in history. So after living a long time in England, when he returned, he didn't want to live with the father in the palace ground and what people in England, because he was Western educated, so he wanted to live independently with his one wife. You see, the father, grandfather, like the kings of old, in the days of old, they were allowed to have many wives.
Okay.
But he, being Western educated, he got a new one.
Mm-hmm.
So that was another reason he did not to live in the palace ground. So this house you are in now was built for him while he was crown prince. His father was the ruling chief. We don't have kings. The British left the Shan chiefs, you were under them. So we have altogether 33 small little states in Shan State.
Yeah.
Each with a hereditary chief. They are feudal lords. So they are not kings. So he was the crown prince. So this house was built for the crown prince in 1924. So in 7 years' time, this house will be 100 years old. That's why if we got a helping to upkeep the palace, because it belongs to history. You see, we were under the ministry and we were not for over 50 years. We couldn't do any renovation, but now the country is free. And then the gardens are elected leader, I'm San Suu Kyi, so now we have to upkeep the palace. So if you want to help, you are welcome.
Okay.
I'm allowed to charge $5 each. If I don't, if you want to help, you can say at least $1. That's a benchmark. So, when the father died, he succeeded the father, and he and his one wife continued to live. But then just before Second World War passed, he was suffering from tuberculosis, TB. We had a time no cure, but we went to England, no cure, so when he returned, he was in his 40s, he died. And when he died, no children. So no one to take care of him. And then the British took care of the administration, but Second World War broke out, so the British were driven out of Burma by the Japanese. Then in 45, when World War II ended in Burma, together with the Allies, the British came to take over Burma. And to drive the Japanese out of Burma, they dropped bombs around the buildings in Burma, so also in Paris.
Paris
was
destroyed.
Yes, it was bombed. But this house was not touched by the bomb. Because as maybe you know, during end of Second World War, the bombs that were dropped just destroyed the building. Bombs dropped. It doesn't spread.
Yeah.
So this house was safe. So the British came back, they were burned the country. Then from 1948, Burma got independence from the British. And all the Shan chiefs, after the three of them, they were reinstated. My father was the last ruling prince of Hsipaw, 60 miles off east of Hsipaw. But Hsipaw was without a ruler because he left no children to take after him. So Hsipaw needed a ruler. So what happened was his uncle, his father's youngest brother, happened to have two sons.
Okay.
So the two sons are his cousin. So no sons, so the rulership of Hsipaw went to the two cousins. The elder one happened to be her husband Donald's father. My father-in-law was the elder brother. And the younger one became the last prince who married Inge from Austria. So as even in Holland,
where are you from?
France. Even in Ghana, Ireland, in the days of old, the hereditary Tangji, on the Shanji, if on the Shan State government, and the chosen head, went from the neighbor's day, and Donald's father, who were very good friends. So he was called to Tangji by his friend to help on the Shan State government, so that instead of becoming the ruling prince, he left from Tangji, became secretary of Shan State government. So he was after the whole Shan State, a younger brother. And his husband became the ruling prince. So he doesn't understand. So the prince is my husband Donald's uncle. Donald is a prince. So when he became rich, as I told him, Rome Palace was born, he lived here. So this became the palace of the last prince. And then he wanted to study mining engineering as a geologist. He made surveys all over Shan State. He found there are lots of minerals to be found in Shan State. So he wanted to bring out the minerals to help develop Shan State. So he left Sabwa to his ministers to look after, and he went to America to study mining engineering in Denver, in the Colorado School of Mines. And while studying there, he met Inge Sargent from Austria. She managed to get a Fulbright scholarship. That's why she did all studying in Denver. So as students, they met, they fell in love after getting married in Denver, and they were to do all the things around. And from? So, he met the father in 1953 after getting married in Denver. The next year, 54, the prince brought his bride to Sipo. That's why Sipo has an Austrian for a princess.
Has an Austrian
for a princess?
Yes,
princess. So, no problem. Because, although Burma was used to the British, even that's a woman nearly 100 years, so no problem. And also, Inga, after she got here, she changed herself. Adapted as well. She dressed like us every day in her costume and also learned to speak and write Argentina, she adapted so very much, except for that. So, Inga, after arriving here 2 years later, she knew the only wife, she got the title, the chief wife, which was Devi. It's a title for all Shan chief's wives. It means the great lady of the temple. And because the people of Sabwa, they can't call her by her Austrian name, Inge Sargent, so they gave her a Shan name, Sawbwa, literally translated means Princess Good Moon, or Good Moon Princess. And they had two daughters, Mayuri, and her daughter, and Kinga. And Inge, arriving here, 55, 3 years later, 1964, she had to be a Burma because 1962, 3 years earlier, maybe they were but Burma, the military took over, Kuntitan, staged by the army strongman, General Inge. You see, he was already preparing secretly to seize the power. He needed an excuse. So what happened was, you see, all the central Burmese government, they were ruling the country there, parliament, democracy, ethics under them. They promised equal stages, but ethics were out. They were suppressed, they didn't have equality as promised. So, end of February, they were planning, the next month, 2nd March 1962, at the parliament meeting, they were planning to ask for federation. Federation are practiced all over the world. Federation in each state, with its own elected state government, under the Union of Burma government, so that they get equal status. That was what they were going to ask for. General Naiman, preparing to seize the power, when he heard that the ethics were about to ask for federation before they could ask, 2nd March 1962, early in the morning, the sunrise, he seized the power. And starting from the president, prime minister, members of the ethnic leaders, attended the meeting in Rangoon, they were all rounded up, arrested, and put in prison. Half among the Shan leaders that were arrested, included the Sipo prince, his older brother, Donald's father, member of the Shan State government, and my father, prince of a neighboring state. So three of them were included with the detainees arrested and prison and surrounded. And General Naiman, 8 o'clock, the very 2nd March morning, on radio, he declared to the country, he explained. He said, federation, which the ethics were about to ask for, he said it meant separation. That's all. So with federation, the country is going to be separated. It's going to fall to pieces. So he didn't want that to happen. So he had to save the country. being separated. So that was his excuse of seizing the power. 2nd March, 1962, that time. So up to last year, here's what happened. So up to last year, 2016, for over 50 years, nearly 60 years, Burma was under military rule. So as you know, instead of developing, Burma became the least developed in Southeast Asia under the military rule. But hopefully now, 1 year already, we have the elected government of the people elected in Nadi. Went down to Rangoon so that once a week through the war office they could write and receive letters. But Ingra was living here. I told you no palace, so they lived here, so this became the palace. And Ingra, she arrived 54 up to 62. If she wanted, she could apply for citizenship, but she didn't as yet. So when the military took over, Ingra was still a foreigner. That's why the gate you came in, soldiers guarded the gate. People coming in, going out, had to give an account. Only when they gave her permission, Ingra could leave the gate. So she couldn't get news from outside Sipo. But 6 months after the takeover, Ronald's mother, my mother-in-law living in Tongji, was allowed to visit Ingra because their husbands are brothers. So when Ingra heard that letters could be written, she wrote a letter hoping to get and gave it to the military here in Sipo. But the military refused to take Inga's letter because they told Inga, the revolutionary council did not arrest the Sipo prince. That's what they told Inga. But Inga secretly she received a note which her husband managed to smuggle out to her. It's in the book, page 175. In the German book, it has a postmark who's got marking the page. So she has evidence from the letter that her husband's brother wrote, written 2nd March 16th, the very day he was arrested, and yet the day the military took him. So she has evidence. She knew from the note that her husband was arrested. But now when she went to give the letter to her refuse, he said he didn't arrest him. So I started wondering, why should they deny his arrest? So living here under house arrest, she couldn't find out. So hoping to find her husband, with the other detainees in the prison outside Rangoon, she asked for permission to go down. Permission given, so in 1963, the next year, with her two daughters, they left for Rangoon. And once in Rangoon, she could be searching later on with help from the American, Austrian embassies and some ex-parliamentarian friends. Secretly, they had to search because the military said they didn't arrest him, so they found out that the prince was dead.
Oh,
prince
was?
But up to now they deny, so he's regarded as missing.
Nobody knows.
Up to now nobody knows. So Inga, after finding out that her husband was no more, she knew as a foreigner it would be dangerous to continue living. Until she found out that her husband was no more, she knew as a foreigner. She would be dangerous to live under the military government as a foreigner without a husband. So in 1964, with her two daughters, she had a mother. The two girls were born here. And with help from the embassy members in Rangoon, they somehow managed to help prove the two daughters were Austrian citizens. She could take their mother Burma. And since my husband, my name is Fern, my husband, Daniel, was the nephew of the prince, so Inga met Daniel in charge. That was why for over 40 years we've been living here.
Yeah.
We don't live here, and we have left a lot of educated relatives left from her, because that very year Inga left, the military made the country into a socialist country. Everything became state-owned. No more the big shops, up to one-room shops, everything became state-owned. No more work, unless government employee, and the pay was very low. So a lot of educated relatives in fact, if we had left to you, we'd be like, then the house would be empty. And if the house is empty, the military would take over, and you won't be here today. And Daniel and I, it belongs to my father's family, and belongs to history. So we still down the road of our children here, children and our grandson, so it's still in our hands. It's not our only foreigners, locals do, because of the four locals day and night. because we are relatives of the Shan chiefs. They are afraid if they are seen very friendly with us, they lose their job. So we don't come. And now, as you know, the country is free, and that the main government are now So it's taking a lot of time because my husband is not here, he's in town looking after
the family house.
Furious.
Yes, but so of us, Inga, she can sit down and be tired. So first, Inga, she went back to Austria to get her started. Later on, she started to be better to educate her children. She married her for the future, so she took them back to Denmark. She met her husband, who was here to live, and worked there. They're not allowed to come. It's 20 years military because after they left, 65, she and her two daughters, they ran to the military government asking after the Sea Prince. They know he's no more, but they hope to get a written confirmation with a different reply. There's no reply, what she said, they didn't listen. And although no reply, they keep on writing her asking her either. So the military government, the Ghanaian has about more. So Inga brother or two daughters in America, and 4 years after she left, 6 years after the takeover in 1965, those members took 2nd March 1962, and the families everywhere, the father, daughter's father, and the Sabwa comes up to now. So other than him, he will be 90 this year, so he will be very killed. Up to now, nobody knows why he was killed, when, where, how, nobody knows, and who has been caught. So nobody knows. And even here, during the election, we have people try to find out who will be around in the trap. So Inga brought up for $2 in 1994, back over. That's how she looked when she was when she retired. She was almost 60. That's when she wrote the book, Twilight. She's married again to her married. That's why the book she wrote under her married name, Inge Sargent. All the American citizens. Hello. Mr. Dato, not much, but it's still from Germany. So you know Inge? So Inga now, she's in, she was 85, February. She's old,
clear.